Today, I want to welcome you in the name of the Lord. This is Tabernacle of David, and this is week number 8, lesson number 8. Let me give you a quick overview as to how we're going to finish out our course. After today, we'll have 4 weeks remaining in our course. Today, we're going to essentially complete our actual study of the Tabernacle of David. And when I speak about finishing the Tabernacle of David, I'm talking about the preliminary background information. And next week, we're going to take a specific look at the spiritual significance of Zion, keeping in mind that Zion is the mountain where the Tabernacle of David was built, where the Ark of the Covenant resided. And we're going to talk about Mount Zion in the context of the mountains about Jerusalem. And those mountains would be, of course, Sinai, Mount Gibeon, Mount Moriah, and Zion. Then week number 10, we're going to be looking at the divine order of worship and the order of the singers and musicians. And if we have time, we'll take a look at the musical instruments that were used in the Tabernacle of David, and which are spelled out more specifically in the book of Psalms. And then week 11, I'm looking forward to this because I taught a class on praise and worship back a couple years ago, and this happened to be one of the lessons there, and that is a brief history of music in the church. This is very, very interesting, and I think that it will certainly be significant to our study of the Tabernacle of David. And then week 12, we're going to tie all the loose ends together, summarize, draw conclusions. And we're going to be looking at some topics such as going back, revisiting the Ark of the Covenant. We're going to talk a little bit more in depth about the golden censer. We're going to talk about the Song of the Lord and the spiritual priesthood that functions in the new temple, and that's the temple of the Holy Spirit. Okay, today we're going to pick back up in the latter part of lesson number 7, and this is when the ark is being taken from the house of Obed-Edom. Let's go back very, very quickly and to summarize pretty much the history of the ark. Of course, the ark was constructed somewhere around 1400 B.C. Under the guidance of Moses, the pattern that God had showed Moses in the heavenlies. And for about 300 years, the Ark of the Covenant resided primarily in Shiloh. And there's an interesting study of Shiloh. Shiloh, of course, meaning peace. And then there was a time of a period of about a period of 100 years where the Ark of the Covenant was in various places. And finally, the Ark of the Covenant is taken out of the camp of the Israelites. And I think that this may have been for maybe a period of about 30 years. So about 450 years. Is a history of the ark up until the time that we're studying here. And eventually, of course, the Ark of the Covenant was taken in the Babylonian captivity, and men have been looking for it ever since. And they're looking for the wrong thing. They're looking in the wrong places, because the Ark of the Covenant is a person. The Ark of the Covenant is no longer a box, and anything that God gave as a type in the Old Testament has a spiritual fulfillment. And of course, the spiritual is the reality. What you do not see is real. What you see is temporal. What you don't see is eternal. And so the reality of the Ark of the Covenant is a spiritual reality, and that was fulfilled in Christ Jesus. So if you're looking for the Ark of the Covenant, if you're looking for the residing place of the presence of God, you'll not find it in a box. So you recall the story how that the Ark of the Covenant was being moved by an ox cart. And when the ox cart ran over a rock and the Ark of the Covenant became unsettled, there was an individual, Uzzah, U-Z-Z-A-H, who reached out to steady the Ark. And of course, the Ark, being holy, was not to be touched with human hands. He fell over dead. And of course, this immediately caused everyone to say, well, let's take a look and see if we're doing this properly. Apparently, they must have known that there was a violation of some holy principle. Otherwise, I suppose that you could have said, well, Uzzah had a heart attack, and it had nothing to do with the transportation of the Ark. But apparently, there was an awareness that they had breached the principle that God had laid out as to how the Ark was to be transported. Now, all of the other parts of the Tabernacle of Moses were transported by an ox cart. But the Ark of the Covenant was specifically to be borne upon the shoulders of the priesthood. You had your four rings on each corner of the Ark, and you had two staves that went through two rings on each side, and you had, a minimum of four priests who bore the Ark of the Covenant. I'm sure that it was only four, because the Ark of the Covenant was really not that large. So when the breach took place, David said, we are going to allow this Ark of the Covenant to remain in the house of Obed-Edom. Now, we want to take a closer look at the study of Obed-Edom. In fact, make a note of this. In the course of this study, I want us to consider seven major characters, seven major men. Now, this may not be addressed in your study guide, and I think that what I'm going to do, and the only way you're going to know this is by listening to the video. This is for those who are viewing by video. What happens oftentimes, I think, is that students are, for some reason, are more interested in credit than they are in learning. And that's not really being fair to say that, I suppose, but I think there is a part of human nature that's going to seek to slide, especially if you feel a crunch of time or whatever. And so when you discover that all you have to do is study the study guide and fill out the study guide and read your manual to prepare for the exam, then there's probably no reason to watch the videos. But I would have to say that there is plenty that we're talking about that may not be included in the study guide. And so what I'm going to do is to embed throughout the course. We haven't necessarily drawn your attention to this, so it wouldn't really be fair to hold you accountable for something I don't hold your attention to. So keep this in mind, that I am going to be making you aware of what I will call some embedded questions, meaning questions that you could be held accountable for on your final examination that may not be addressed on your study guides. So one of the things that I want to bring your attention to, make you aware of, is that I want you to be able to identify the major importance of seven men. And of course, Moses, David, and Solomon, being the most obvious ones, are the ones that we're more aware of. And Moses, of course, being associated with his tabernacle, and that's what the study is all about, a comparison between the tabernacle of Moses and the tabernacle of David. And then I want you to understand David's involvement in this study and Solomon. And of course, Solomon's contribution. Moses is the tabernacle of Moses, David the tabernacle of David, and then Solomon would be the temple. And this represents a progression of the residing places for the Ark of the Covenant. But keep in mind that none of those represented the true dwelling place. The true dwelling place is in the true temple, and that true temple is the body of Christ. That we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. We are the house of God. We house the glory of God, and the glory of God is going to be revealed in the earth, not out in midair, but it's going to be revealed through people. Now, the next four men that I want you to be aware of, and we're going to be talking about each one of these men. Today, we're going to be talking about Obed-Edom, the significance of Obed-Edom and how he plays into the scheme of things. We're going to be taking a look at two of the major priests, Zadok and Abiathar. Now that'll be today, Obed-Edom, Zadok, and Abiathar. And I believe it'll probably be in lesson 10 that we're going to be talking about Asaph. Asaph being the chief musician, I guess you could say the top praise and worship leader in the tabernacle, around the tabernacle of David, and that'll be addressed in lesson number 10. Let's take a look now at Obed-Edom. And now, what is the significance of Obed-Edom? Well, let me give you a little background information on Obed-Edom. The meaning of the name is a servant of Edom. A servant of Edom. Now, you got to keep in mind that Edom was a Gentile nation, and this is very, very important, because this is really the major significance of the tabernacle of David and it being restored, as was accounted for in Acts chapter 15. You recall that James quotes the prophet Amos and says that God will once again build the tabernacle of David, and the reference is specific in Amos that it would be open to Edom. And James says that it'll be embrace the Gentiles. So specifically, Amos is speaking about a tribe of Edom. And Edom, I believe, is the descendants of Esau. Now, you've got to keep this in proper perspective, because all along, God has had a chosen lineage through which he would bring forth his promised seed, and that, of course, being Christ. And that lineage was through Abraham and through Jacob, not Ishmael. Of course, Ishmael being another lineage, but through Jacob and not through Esau. Well, Abraham, Isaac, I'm leaving out a major character. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. And Isaac being the chosen one instead of Ishmael. And then Jacob being the chosen one instead of Esau. Of course, Esau was the firstborn. And by tradition, he was to be the heir, or he was to receive the blessing of his father. And we won't go through all the details of that. But we need to understand that the Ishmaelites, even though they were not in the direct lineage of the promised seed, that they were, God promised that he would make the seed of Ishmael a very powerful for us a very powerful people, a powerful nation. In fact, God said he would bless them. And I believe that ultimately all the nations of the earth are going to be blessed. And one of the reasons is because God has promised to rebuild the tabernacle of David. And then again, when we get down to Jacob, Jacob had a lineage through which the Christ came. But Esau also became a powerful nation. And Edom is represents the descendants of Esau. So the word Obed-Edom means servant of Edom. That's a good test question. Obed-Edom means a servant of Edom. And keep in mind that Edom is a Gentile nation, and oftentimes an enemy of the nation of Israel. Obed-Edom was a Levite described in the scripture as a Gittite. That is probably a native of the Levitical city of Gath-Rimmon in Manasseh, which was assigned to the Kohathites. After the death of Uzzah, the ark, which was being conducted from the house of Abinadab in Gibeah to the city of David, was carried aside into the house of Obed-Edom, where it continued for 3 months. Now, the important thing to understand here is that Obed-Edom was not born a Jew, even though that he was a part of the Levitical order. Originally, Obed-Edom came from one of the tribes of the uncircumcised lords of the Philistines called the Gittites. During the days of the prophet Samuel, Obed-Edom's tribe had kidnapped this ark. Now keep in mind this picture, that Obed-Edom's tribe had kidnapped the ark. According to 1 Samuel 5 and 9,